Welcome back, Health Impact audience. We are finishing up our day today with a great panel talking about how we can cut costs while continuing to innovate and scale our services, but also improve care if possible. So if the promises of technology are truly there and are giving us the returns on the investment that we're thinking, we should be able to save some costs through the use of technology, but also improve care. And that's why we have a great panel to talk about the idea of how do you make that happen? Not just the fact that it's possible, but what are we going to do? And so we've got Doug, Stephen, and Eli. I'm going to start with Eli. If you can give us a little bit of introduction about yourself, we'll then go to Stephen and Doug, and then we'll jump into our first question.
Great. Thanks, Shahid. Good afternoon, everybody. So as Shahid mentioned, my name is Eli Tarlo. I currently serve as one of the directors of healthcare for Sirius's healthcare practice. Before I joined Sirius in the beginning of 2020, I had an exciting career as a chief information officer for a couple of hospitals in the Northeast, notably Bellevue Hospital, Brookdale Hospital, Metropolitan Hospital, and a couple other leadership positions in healthcare. So moved over to the, I call it, brighter side, and enjoying my view from this end.
Thanks. No, that's great to see that we've changed the term dark side to brighter side. That's very nice. Stephen.
Yeah, thank you. Stephen Michaels, I'm the Vice President and Chief Technology Officer for SCL Health. We're based out of Colorado. We have eight hospitals in Colorado's Front Range, as well as we've got three care sites in the Montana region. And so I've been with the organization just shy of about a year and a half. I've been in healthcare for the last 12 years, well, actually 13 now. So, but I always tell people that I pretended to be in healthcare for the first 10 because I was in pharmaceutical. And so it wasn't until I moved over to the provider side that you start to see some real challenges outside of supply chain. So great to be here.
Great point. Doug?
Hey, yes, I'm Doug McMillan. I work for Cone Health, based out of Greensboro, North Carolina. I'm currently serving as the interim chief information security officer and executive director for IT technical operations.
Excellent. So we've got a lot of problems that we're dealing with today, not the least of which is, of course, the virus. But along with that is we have a drop in revenue for most providers and an unknown distance on when that's going to come back. So as we look at these kind of problems, are there some ideas that you have to help figure out where costs can be contained and where they can be cut? And I'll start with Doug and Stephen for you guys to kind of comment from the provider side. And Eli, you know, one of the things I love about Sirius is your team is filled with ex-CIOs, ex-SSOs, et cetera, that come from the hospitals and health systems. So you know this from like yesterday, literally, because you just joined in 2020. But I'd love for you to comment on what Doug and Stephen are saying with your purview of seeing multiple clients. So Doug, we'll start off with you. What are your what is your board asking you to do? What are your chief financial officer and chief executive officer asking you to do from a cost containment perspective, if anything?
Yeah, so obviously, I think like most healthcare organizations, you know, really, and this is obviously from COVID, we had to really step back and look across all, you know, the entire organization and look at all of our strategies to make sure that we're reevaluating them based off of the changes that were brought to us. However, one of the large ones we feel are is going to continue to be increased usage is focusing on our digital health and well-being. And as part of that is from a core infrastructure perspective, we are banking a lot on how to use cloud-based services to be able to meet the digital health and well-being, as well as the changes that are going to come naturally as our workforce continues to shift to a digital-based workforce, which also was, you know, escalated throughout the COVID. And then just from a technology perspective, I hate to use those words, but robotic process automation also brings a lot of potential into this arena where we can look at trying to decrease costs by not spending so many man hours on some monotonous workflows.
Got it. Stephen, how about you? What are your cost containment strategies? And maybe tell us a little bit about what your board and others are asking you for, if anything specific.
Sure. So one thing I'll say as far as SCL Health is concerned, you know, we were recently recognized by Becker's as, you know, kind of navigating this this storm financially pretty well. And our organization has a fantastic executive leadership team that has done a remarkable job that has allowed us to kind of navigate these rough waters pretty well. So generally speaking, we haven't had to, cut back anything radically or anything like that. We've been able to kind of stay the course for the most part. But, you know, in generally speaking, as I'm sure Doug and Eli would be able to agree, is that cutting costs in technology and healthcare has kind of been a trend for many years. So I believe for COVID, it's really just kind of accelerated things to a certain degree. As Doug said, looking at cloud, trying to reduce some of our on-premise footprint in areas that would be like disaster recovery, for example, where I'm paying for 100% of an environment waiting for a rainy day, right? And whereas, I can partner, with my technology partners to burst into the cloud and kind of do those sort of things. Those are really key for us. But, kind of getting through COVID really has just been, a lot of just staying focused on really what's essential and what's necessary. A lot of, work that we've done similar to Doug around, chatbots and things like that to try to be more efficient. But again, a lot of those things were already in the works. And so, that allowed us to kind of accelerate some of the things during COVID when they became a little more critical. So,
yeah. And if you and Doug can comment on this point, that it, as you look towards the cloud, do you see it mainly to help you do innovation and things that you couldn't do on-prem? Or is cloud really being seen as a cost-cutting, cost-savings, and efficiency measure? And I ask that because for many of us that have been in the cloud for years, sometimes our costs actually go up quite a bit, and then they start to come down later on as we gain the efficiencies and don't have to do two things, like keep our on-prem and our cloud at the same time. Doug, how did you see that? And then we'll have Eli comment on what you and Stephen talk about.
Yeah, so I think it's both. And I'll split that up. So obviously, we've been looking at cloud usage for a while. And as we were talking earlier, Cone Health actually recently moved its Epic disaster recovery environment to Azure. We completed that work as around October of 2019. And just in August, we did a full failover to that environment and ran production out of Azure for an entire week. So that worked extremely well. And the reason I say both around cost cutting and innovation is obviously I think the innovation, it makes easier sense to people because obviously there's going to be new technology, new features, new functionality that comes out and you can easily take advantage of that from a cloud-based environment than you can re-architecting your entire on-premise environment. But from a disaster recovery in particular, kind of similar to what was just mentioned a minute ago, is you don't have to pay for 100% of that environment when it's not needed. So disaster recovery environment, shifting that over to a cloud-based architecture has tremendous potential for saving, a ton of money. And we've already seen that because, we had done that work in 2019. Now, it took us a full year of really planning and doing the needed migrations from Epic's perspective, because we were on AIX, we had to convert to Linux, and then we did the shift. But throughout all that work, the cost savings was enormous.
That's great. Stephen, do you agree with that? Or did you have to plan for a higher cost and then for the cost to come down?
Well, we're actually in the early stages. So I'm a few steps behind Doug for sure. So we're kind of going through the application dependency mapping and applications performance mapping. And actually Eli's company is actually helping us with that, Sirius Technologies. And so once we have that, the goal would be to have, a roadmap planned out. But my expectation is that there would be some initial investment that would have to have some sort of ROI. I have a similar challenge as Doug with Epic and its dependency on AIX. My challenge may be a little more daunting, though, in that, we are a strategic partner with Google. And so we're actually engaged in a SOW right now, setting up our environment to where our presentation layer can burst into GCP. So we're actually partnering with Epic partnering with Google to kind of get the agreements in place, because like unlike Azure, Azure's kind of already got the highway created for you as far as Epic is concerned. There is no such thing for GCP. So we're really leveraging our three-way partnership to make that happen. But the expectation, just like with Doug, is that, you know, we'll be a lot more elastic, a lot more nimble, and, you know, actually reduce our costs in that DR environment for Epic specifically. So,
yeah, it sounds like, Eli, that Stephen and Doug are on the right path. What are you seeing? Feel free to comment on what they said, but maybe broaden it out for the rest of our audience that is seeing other hospitals and health systems. Is the cloud now just it's a matter of course now? It's not one of those where you're doing a trial, you're not doing pilots, et cetera. You're just like moving into the cloud. Is that true? And if so, how should people plan for that, you know, from a workforce and a budgeting perspective to say, do you need to do, you know, two environments and support that for the next 6 months, a year, 2 years, and then you'll see costs come down? Or is there another plan that you're suggesting from Sirius as you're talking to customers?
Sure. Thanks, Shane. If I could just take a step back on the larger topic, you know, about reducing costs and continue to be innovative. And what's interesting about technology is that it does both. You know, technology is really about reducing costs. You know, Doug mentioned RPA, which I'll, you know, comment on in a moment. So technology exists in any organization, in any industry, frankly, about to reduce costs, right? To remove barriers, to find automated ways of placing other services. On the other hand, technology is also about growing the business and about looking at ways that you can be competitive against others in the same area or in the same industry. So technology plays a dual role there. Perhaps other services and organizations do the same, but that's something that I find interesting. And then the second thing to really consider is the organizational culture around how they perceive technology. And so having been at multiple organizations in executive or leadership positions, you know, I looking at one end of the spectrum, they looked at IT as having an insatiable appetite, right, for funds. And, you know, it's always about, what do you guys want now? Now it's always about, you always knock on the door for money. You never come and tell us, et cetera, et cetera. And then you have the other organizations that would include a CIO or other IT leaders, you know, at the beginning of the very, very first conversation for how to improve any part of the quadruple aim, right? Whether it's or patient care, and saying, okay, we need to have an IT presence in the room talking about strategy, talking about how do we grow the business. And obviously you have organizations that are anywhere in that spectrum, right? From, you know, seeing it as a cost center and seeing it as a truly enabler in the business. So I think that's the second thing to really recognize within an organization, within a hospital. And just to comment on why that's so important, you know, we talk about RPA. And, I'm a really big fan. I think there's a really big play in it. RPA, robotic process automation, is not anymore something that's, you know, very cool, techy, futuristic. It's something that every organization needs to be aware of and really considering on the one hand. On the other hand, if you have an organization that's not going to let employees go when they have a way of eliminating or even repurposing and maybe closing down vacancies, you can bring the greatest RPA tool in and they're not going to, you know, reduce their headcount. Similarly with cloud, right? And we talk about cloud being, you know, something that's not any more innovative, right? I mean, I would argue with anybody that cloud is not any more futuristic. It's not sci-fi. Cloud is another way of serving your EHR, your ERP, any of your portfolio. And, you know, if you have a hospital that has a data center 6 miles down the road, well, you're kind of in the cloud. It might be your own data, but it's a network connection that connects you to your systems, right? So, I mean, cloud is really about trusting another provider, someone who's, you know, not only loyal to your organization, that they can do a better job than you. So you can talk about cloud all you want, but if the organization still feels that they need to keep their crown jewels in their brick and mortar four walls, you have to have that conversation first. You know, Stephen mentioned, you know, we're working with them on application rationalization, right? If you have a group of doctors that don't want to let go of their 65th, you know, OB fetal monitoring system, you can have all the greatest technology. So I think, you know, number one is recognizing the leading organizations are the ones that really can value IT as helping grow their business. Number two is that they're willing to make business decisions based on the technology. And I think all these ideas are phenomenal ideas, and you can just, you know, I don't want to throw any names out there, but you can certainly see the ones that are really the leading hospitals are the ones that recognize that IT is an innovator and that they have to really join with the business. So a little bit of a mouthful. I hope I gave some perspective.
No, that's actually good perspective. If you look across customers, though, there is this concern about costs during the early time. What do you normally see? Does it go up and then come down? Does it go up and stay there? What are you seeing at your different customers?
Sure. So, you know, obviously, again, it depends on the solution. It depends on how fast you can go in a short amount of time. There's some solutions, there's some RPA solutions that, you know, you'll see an ROI in 30 days or less, or 90 days or less. So that's, you know, that's, you know, most CFOs and hospitals need to see it 90 days or less, certainly in a month. Obviously, if you're looking at something much larger like application rationalization, until you can actually turn down those systems and figure out, you know, the strategy around having the systems for legal purposes or for look back, then you might see something a little bit longer until you can actually turn off the other systems. It really does depend on the solution and on timing, but there's a lot of technology solutions that can bring things in really quickly from an ROI. You know, we looked at telehealth was huge, right? When we looked at ways for COVID, right? Protecting providers, protecting patients, telehealth from within and without the organization. And, you know, we were able to find some really, really quick solutions with a direct ROI that was like within a week, right? I mean, if a doctor used their regular smartphone and they could actually do a consult over the phone, there's an ROI immediately, right? It would have been a missed opportunity for that patient using existing technology. Now they're looking at an innovative way of providing business. So there's lots, people shouldn't be afraid to jump into innovation thinking that, oh, this is a 2-year or a multi-million dollar investment. They should really explore.
No, I love it. In fact, you said the magic words that ROI, when you pick the right projects, can be in days and weeks, not months and years. And I think that really is the thing that a lot of senior executives, whether it's the boards or CEOs, et cetera, many of them are afraid that, you know, you keep telling us all of this stuff is going to get better and better, but because it's integration is difficult, because the ROIs aren't coming as quickly as we've promised in the past, we're getting somewhat of a gray eye, if not a black eye, in these cases. So, Doug, can you talk a little bit about what are your top two or three priorities at the moment? And it could be for just improving quality of care and innovation, or it could be for cost cutting. So I don't want to stay on necessarily the topic of cost cutting, but if hospitals can't afford to do the right thing or the innovative thing, it doesn't really help to talk about the innovative or right thing. I think it's affordable. And that's why I would love to see, you know, Doug, what are your top two or three priorities that you're focused on in the next maybe 90 to 180 days?
Yeah, sure. So, just reiterating, and I'll use high level terms and then kind of start to break them down a little bit. So from an organizational perspective, again, we're still focused on digital health and digital workforce, which is going to be that enablement. Obviously, that's a very broad term, and you have to really start to break it down and try to layer in new things. So, for example, one of the things that I felt like Cone Health did really well during COVID, and I loved what was mentioned earlier, which was it's not that these things weren't already being worked on; it's just that it escalated the timeline of what we were trying to accomplish. So, for example, you know, televisits. Okay, so we did a really good job of getting things out there, being able to meet the need, meet the demands, continue operations and patient care. And now where we're looking is, well, how do we refine that and take more of a systems-based approach with the platforms to be able to get that cost efficiency as we move forward? And I think that's kind of the key is, we were talking about innovation. I think it's a continual, innovation. It's never a one and done. It's, well, how do I continue to make, improvements and actually bring forward those cost savings? Go ahead.
Yes, but just an expansion on that. So when you think about things like RPA, remote patient monitoring, telehealth, are these top 2, 3, 4 priorities for you guys, or are you pushing them down for other priorities?
No, so they're still at the top of our list. And again, I'd say the list is large. I mean, I think we all deal with that on a daily basis. Yeah. But, standardization around televisits, remote patient monitoring, RPA, virtual patient intake, trying to gain the efficiencies around how do we take patients in and get access and growth moving a lot better and faster over time. Again, well-being, not so much just focused on health care, but also well-being, which is a very large change. And I mean, I guess you could get into maybe a consumerization type model, which obviously is becoming pervasive as you see things like Walmart and Amazon kind of stepping into the space. So it's really all of these encompassing in, again, very large topics to handle. But, you know, around each one of these strategies, we're trying to break them down into manageable initiatives and projects that we can move forward and continue to make that curve.
Makes sense. Yeah. And Stephen, when you think about strategy, do you think that for your organization, you want to depend more and more on fewer and fewer vendors, maybe going deeper into the platforms that you have? Or are the current vendors that you have in-house insufficient with respect to what's new, what your needs are today versus what they were a year ago? What does that look like? Are you opening the aperture for more to come in, or trying to close that down, especially during application rationalization? I'm sure you're trying to get rid of as many apps as possible. Is that the strategy, or is it something else?
Yeah, so one of the things that we did at SEL Health is we kind of put together a strategy that encompasses what we call products and platforms. And so we have five products within our ITDS, or IT Digital Services, as we call it. And those five products are technology, which is my responsibility, digital, so digital front door, you know, all the work similar to what Doug was talking about. Applications. So we have a focused on clinical revenue cycle applications. We have data. So data lake, data warehousing, that source of data analytics. And then the last one is governance or security. And to kind of complement those is we do have those platform partnerships that we consider to be our strategic partners. And the goal for those are for us to, from a rationalization perspective, we will ask ourselves if any of these five platforms can do what you're currently doing or what you're asking to do. Maybe it could be new. And so those five are Google, so we're a G Suite shop, GCP, as well as we're actually changing our desktop standard to Chromebooks and Google Voice as our standard voice offering, as well as Pixels on the hospital floor. So we take each one of these partnerships and go deep. Well, the other four are Oracle from an ERP perspective, ServiceNow from a service management perspective, Epic from a EMR perspective, and then Salesforce from a consumer experience. So you're spot on that we try to go deep with those partnerships as much as possible, because what we found is, specifically I can speak to Google, is because we go deep, they actually come to the table with even more innovative solutions. And we, you know, we're a part of their early adopters program, for example. We get a lot of features before other Google customers get. And so we really get a lot out of that. And it allows us to be able to have those two partners talking to each other at a deeper level, simplifying the environment and getting more benefit for SEL Health as a whole.
No, that's very interesting. And Doug, if you were to comment on Stephen's points, does that seem familiar in your environment as well? You know, narrowing down on the platforms and then going deep, and then you maybe even acting as the integrator between these platforms, or do you like to expand the aperture a bit more than what Stephen is saying?
So, no, I 100% agree with that strategy. I mean, I would say, you know, five, again, we probably have more than that as a total, obviously, because, I think around, like we've mentioned, RPM, that seems like a use case that falls outside of those platforms. But again, we take that platform-based approach. Again, to go as deep as we can, run as many use cases, decrease the amount of technical debt that we have in our environment, which, let's be honest, over the last few years has become astronomical as things start to become interconnected. So, yes, hands down agree. That is kind of where we are looking for, is what are our core platforms that are going to be needed to pull all of these together to make these initiatives work and in such a fashion that we can support it going forward without having to keep coming to the well, as you mentioned, asking for more money, more resources, more FTEs.
Yeah, that's fantastic. And in fact, when you look at it, from our audience perspective and folks listening to this, what I'm hoping they get the sense of is that the hospital technology leadership's job seems to be more and more as an integration team rather than a development or the old time pure IT selection and those kind of things. So that seems very interesting. Now, Eli, during COVID, one thing we saw was obviously there was a quite precipitous decline in surgeries and visits, et cetera. Did that reduction in requirements make it any easier to do application rationalization, remove things that were not used before, or does it actually make it harder? And maybe a way to answer that question is that if we're going to do more things with less resources, we have to have fewer things that we have to support in IT. Is that easier now, or is it worse than it was before COVID?
Sure. Thanks, Shahid. Yeah. It's deferring the electives, right? That's a large revenue driver, the largest probably for most organizations. And, we had that period, right, where the money wasn't coming in. And we can argue whether or not it's been deferred or eliminated going forward. I think one of the things that it did was it forced us to look at other ways of doing more with less. So, I think it was Stephen and both and Doug mentioned earlier that this is not something new, right? Doing more with less, just like every other business, right? That's how you remain competitive, is about, really shrinking your margins. But when times are difficult, then you're forced to come up with some creative solutions. So whether or not it was necessary all along to grow the business, for a lot of hospitals now, it's really about just sustainability and just staying open. So now they're forced to consider, innovative ways of reducing their costs. But it's not anything new. You mentioned, Shahid, before, the comment you said was, can hospitals afford to do certain, innovative ideas now? And I would ask the opposite. Can hospitals afford to not do that? Take a look at the airline industry, and right, so they went from paper tickets to everything being done on a phone, and I can just imagine what a lift that must have been for any airline to go from what was paper, easy, simple, inexpensive, and now they have to roll this platform out. I don't think anybody would fly in an airline that doesn't do that. Whether you use it or not, you're not going to take them serious. They don't already have that option. It's not much different from hospitals. Today, something might be considered innovative. Tomorrow, if the hospital doesn't have that, you're not going to shop there, right? I mean, assuming quality, assuming everything remains the same, you're going to look at an easier way of doing something, a patient portal way, an Uber picking you up. So today, it's, can a hospital afford to do that? And tomorrow, it's going to be, can a hospital, how did you not do that? You're not, it's just not sustainable much longer. And just the other comment you made on the ROI, typically in my, I'm guilty when I was a CIO, we always try to, make the ROI argument, right? Because we knew the technology. We, we read the white papers, we looked at the studies, we spoke to our buddies, and we knew this is a home run. And the burden of the ROI was on the IT leader. And that's a recipe for a disaster. The hospital, again, coming back to the culture, has to appreciate. And whether it's the medical officer, the financial officer, whether it's application rationalization, cloud, RPA, whatever that might be, there's got to be someone in the business making that argument. If it's RPA and it's about reducing headcount, well, your chief HR officer should be there with you. So, that's really, a mindset change in a lot of organizations. And frankly, most of them are there already.
Yeah, makes sense. And in the last few minutes that we have, and then I'm going to turn it over to our live audience to ask questions. Let's talk a little bit about the problem of doing things in the cloud and going fully remote and telehealth and RPM, et cetera, but yet still maintaining some semblance of privacy and security. So Doug, we are wearing the interim CISO hat at the moment, the Chief Information Security Officer hat. So talk to us a little bit about, maybe comment on this. Last week, I saw a survey. It was a general industry survey, not just for healthcare, but CIOs reported, 86% of CIOs reported that they had to reduce their either compliance or security requirements in order to meet remote work type of requirements. Do you feel that trade-off is necessary, or now that there's been enough time to take advantage of both secure and remote, that we can do remote securely, or are we still going to be in a pickle here? And you can bring up concepts like, you know, multi-factor authentication. It could be zero trust. Anything that you're doing to maintain security but allow remote to keep working.
Yeah. So I'll start by stating, I think if you're starting from scratch, which I don't think any of us are at this day, no, you don't have to trade off. Now, if in the situation of COVID with things needing to shift literally overnight, I think that's a risk-based decision that every single organization just has to make on their own. There may have been a little bit of give and take, meaning just get something working and then turn around to layer in, you know, the proper controls. Now, again, from Cone Health's perspective, we were very fortunate because of our use for Azure and things like that, where we'd already extended our data centers and footprints out into the cloud. We had already done that kind of, you know, groundwork to make sure that everything that we were doing from an on-prem perspective worked exactly the same within our Azure data centers as well. So again, as if you're looking at it as a strategy, you should not have to give up one or the other. Now, does it mean that all of the tools that you have in your current tool set today are going to work exactly the same? No. And I'll just use an example. So Cone Health, previously we were a very large application whitelisting through Carbon Black, so Carbon Black Protect customer. As we started shifting towards the cloud in 2019, we come to realize is we needed to look and change our security on our endpoints and try to come up with something that was a little more cloud friendly. So we've done those over time, but again, as we had already taken that initiative to kind of change those over time. So what I would say is now you should not have to actually give up on compliance or security. I think it's really just making sure that you move forward with a very focused project level. Here's what I'm trying to do and accomplish and make sure that I'm doing it in the cloud. So for example, as COVID hit for us, obviously outside of the normal, hey, you know, bandwidth, which I think we all, you know, was immediate use case where we're like, okay, we got to start increasing bandwidth quick before everybody starts to shift remote. But then when you start to put that in perspective is, okay, well, what if your data center's in the cloud? Do I really need to increase my bandwidth? You know, because again, as if you have that backend pipe coming through the cloud to your data center, the internet-based circuit really could be coming through Azure and let the cloud handle that. So I think it's really just trying to piecemeal those out and saying, what are you trying to accomplish? But then, just with anything in general with cloud, making sure the visibility, and that to me is key for all of security, is really visibility, and then how do you make sure that you're not missing something from a gap perspective. You know, CASBs exist for this exact reason, to make sure SaaS usage is kind of visible, monitored, controlled, that you can set up, you know, the appropriate admin and technical controls for your cloud-based SaaS usage. And then there's numerous products coming out for as everything is shifting to public cloud, to be able to start looking across all of your configuration items that are sitting in those cloud data centers and look for the appropriate policy-based security settings that you've set, you know, encryption and things like that. So it's really taking that inventory of what you have today, where are you going, and start to make those shifts over time. But again, recognizing COVID completely blew that out of the water, and that's why I think it would be foolish to say that in some situations, in some organizations, they probably did make a little bit of a trade-off, but now it's time to come back around and bring it in and do it the appropriate way so that the risks are mitigated.
No, that's fantastic advice, Stephen.
The trade-offs were interesting because we had a group at SEL Health that had a 2-year plan to move 100 associates to remote. And during COVID, we did it in 3 days. And so, like, you know, so a lot of the obstacles that people perceived quickly went away when you really got to the root of why there was a delay. Things like printing, you know, you really challenged, like, why are you putting it on paper? We're sending you home. We're not buying you a printer. Got to figure out a different way to do that. So there are things like that just because of the situation, they dynamically had to change operations because technically it was always there. even in security stuff, where you think about like credit card swipers and things like that, like they have to be inspected. Okay, great. Well, you inspect them. Like, you know, you still need to continue to do that. It doesn't matter if they're sitting in an office or sitting at someone's home office. And so those types of things helped us really move forward to a remote culture simply because we had to.
Yeah, that makes sense. So Stephen, take us home here. We've got about a minute and a half left before we open up the questions to audience. So is there a requirement to do these trade-offs now, or do you agree with Stephen and Doug that you can maintain a secure environment remotely?
Yeah, I mean, there's always going to be a trade-off, right? I mean, whether it's security, whether it's policy, whether it's, cultural mindset. I think as Stephen just pointed out, there's so many perceived barriers that are just really just perceived, and they're not, and, you know, times of challenge prove otherwise. And, you know, I think every situation is different, but I think the one thing we really learned from COVID is that those are potentially just perceptions. And it's time to take a harder look at, you know, where we can advance. I think that was just well said, Stephen.
No, that's excellent. And definitely want to thank the panelists here. And as we open it up for questions, please type in your questions and our panelists will respond and we'll bring you on live as well. So with that, thank you, Doug, Stephen, Eli, and we look forward to seeing you at a future Health Impact as well.
Thank you.
We've got a great question from Eric, who's been asking splendid questions all day long, that there has been a lot of focus around revenue integrity, risk, quality, compliance, revenues. How are you as panelists addressing revenue integrity at your organizations? And maybe to make sure it's expansive as a question, is there anything about the fact that revenue has dropped precipitously in some areas and a little bit in other areas made things better or worse for revenue cycle management tools? And can the revenue cycle management tools handle the kinds of freezing or subsequent delays in elective surgeries and rescheduling, all of those things? So I'd love for you guys to talk first and foremost, give Eric an answer around what revenue cycle tools you're using today and how well they're working, and what is special about what these tools need to do today versus what they used to do in the past. And Eli, we can start with you if you'd like.
I'll defer most of this response to my colleagues who are still on the front lines. But there's lots to talk about when you talk about revenue integrity. Obviously, it could be integrity from the work that's being performed by the individuals. When I was at an organization, our coders were not part of our core team in-house. And so we had to depend on, ethics and integrity when it came to making sure we weren't, I think the term is upcoding and things along those lines. Telework obviously brings a whole different aspect to that, right? When people are working remotely and you don't necessarily have direct leadership oversight in the same room. I'm a big believer that integrity is not a dependency of a tool. It's a dependency of the people that you hire. So obviously, it's more complex now. It's a little bit more challenging. But there's plenty of great tools out there. I don't want to mention any specific manufacturers. But definitely more complex, but still doable.
Great. And Doug, how are you handling that? And Stephen, you mentioned that you don't have anything to say about tools specifically, but I'd love to hear yours and Doug's view on what are the tools doing and are they able to handle the fact that you've had such a change in the way revenue recognition and income and expenses are working, especially in these crazy times. So Doug, you can go first and then we'll take Stephen.
And I fully admit I am not the revenue cycle point person here. What I obviously we get involved, and what I would start off also by saying is we have a wonderful revenue cycle team at Cone Health. I do work closely with them as well as many people in IT. We use myriad of tools and services as well, and I think that's one of the things that it's always been wonderful to look across is how many relationships that we bring to the table to make sure that we are doing the appropriate things. And again, as we mentioned, coding, I would just use, remote coders internally, but also remote coding services, looking for things that where you can bring in a managed service to be able to do that. And obviously from a security perspective, those always come up as well. because we talk about, offshoring and not offshoring. And that, again, could save you some additional funds, because if you're using that third party service with offshoring, you typically get it at a lower rate, which will help you with your financial situations. So I don't have a lot to say other than, definitely we have a lot of tools in the kit. We constantly are evaluating those based off of the need of the organization. And we also constantly evaluate those against how Epic keeps changing, which I think, again, as you heard us talk about, that platform-based approach is, if you can do it with Epic, obviously we look to try to do that with Epic so that we're saving that, saving money for the organization.
Excellent. And since we just have a couple of minutes, Stephen, you mentioned the Refuel project. If you can give a little bit of information about that and how you might be using either Epic or any other tools for revenue integrity, that'd be great.
Sure. Yeah, I don't have a ton to add about Refuel, as I kind of mentioned in the comments, just simply that it's a project that we're planning underway for the organization and really getting our platforms down to its foundation level. There's some benefits to getting there, doing that. A lot of the integrity and stuff that Eric is talking about comes from really getting the platform into that foundational level. So that's really kind of the benefits of Refuel, getting everybody on the same page. One thing I'd like to add, though, is what was really special for me during the COVID process was watching the teams really come together. Because like as Eli was saying, sometimes, the HIM teams and stuff like that, there's like a little bit of a barrier there. And when we really had to get back to making the patients feel comfortable about coming back into our facilities, we had to really think about creative ways to reach out to them, let them know that it's okay, kind of get some of those procedures and stuff rescheduled. And, there's for folks outside of healthcare, there's a bit of a misnomer that, elective, the term elective, like a lot of elective surgeries are not really elective. I mean, there were people that were in pain, that were putting off some stuff that needed to be done. It wasn't completely elective. And so for us, it was really about using our digital team in partnership with the business to reach those patients and let them know that, things are okay and we can take care of you. And here's how we can kind of get you back scheduled and stuff like that. It was really important to us.
No, that's terrific. No, great advice from all of you. We appreciate you spending the last hour with us. We're closing out for the day here. So I'll just be giving a few concluding remarks. But I want to thank Stephen, Doug, Eli for joining us. And we will see you, of course, at a future Health Impact panel, hopefully. And hopefully tomorrow you'll be able to spend some time with us as well. So with that, I'll thank you guys. And then I'll just summarize for the rest of the audience. Thank you all for attending the day today. We had a lot of different conversations around a variety of different topics, but we started the day, of course, with the topic of misinformation. And in fact, I'd like to conclude today really talking about that and some of the ideas that we discussed with Kevin from UPenn. And that is, if any of you in the community, especially those that are working at health systems or tangential organizations that help health systems, let's try and figure out, could we do that open source, composable content-based model that would help reduce our dependency on government organizations, et cetera, and instead put the healthcare systems right back in the driver's seat for health education. So that doesn't mean that Dr. Google somehow is not useful or that the WebMDs of the world and the Facebooks of the world aren't helpful. But the audience, especially the community of patients and our communities at large, trust health systems, and it would be good for us to figure out how we can work that in. And the other idea that we talked with Kevin about, which he seemed to agree with, was how can we as health systems work together to share our own information that we might already be sharing with government, but as long as there's no privacy, security, or other implications, can we share that data from a crowdsource perspective or from an integration perspective such that we don't have to rely on the government in order to get the data and then disseminate it so we can make it more useful in the future? We have learned that we had not only COVID to contend with, but with misinformation and related problems. These are things that we can work on ourselves. And that's really what I wanted us to hear from the audience, from our speakers and our panelists today, is that there's a lot more under our own control especially now where we have figured out that the barriers to doing what we wanted to do were mostly perceived. And like Eli said just a little while ago, the challenge itself draws us towards it. And so how do we take that and then try to do something more than remote patient monitoring and telehealth and remote, and these things are super, super important and they are needed for today. But there is a small window of opportunity that we have right now over the coming months and year to really adapt how health systems work with each other in order to solve a massive problem like the one we're dealing with misinformation and the government's inability to convene us and have us all work together. So with that, thank you for joining us today. Of course, you'll join us again tomorrow, hopefully at 9 a.m. Pacific, noon Eastern for day two. And day two is going to continue our same pattern here of the no BS, no PowerPoint general rules, good conversations, and most importantly, your interactions. And so that's why these last 15 or 20 minutes of every session are super, super important, because they take your views into account while you're listening to the panelists. So hopefully you'll do that with us again tomorrow. And if you enjoyed today, please let us know in the chat or email or post on LinkedIn. If you didn't like something, we don't want to hear from you. No, just kidding. Please do tell us what you didn't like. If I talk too much, that's okay to tell me too. It's not the first time I will have heard of it, and it's not certainly going to be the last time. So if there's anything we can do to make tomorrow's experience better, it's all live, so there's some things that we can adjust tomorrow. Please do let us know in the chat here or through email. And with that, signing off for the folks at Purpose Events who are actually doing all the work behind the scenes, Megan, Emily, and others doing all that work. Thank you all, and we'll see you tomorrow.